everyone, it's Justin again. Throughout this unit, you've become masters at solving systems of linear equations. And today, we're going to see how we can take those skills and apply them to help us solve real-world problems. In order to do this, we're going to be relying on your ability to write slope-intercept and standard form equations based on real-world scenarios. So, if you need to refresh your memory, feel free to rewatch the lesson videos where you originally learned these skills. They're both linked at the top of your guided notes in your PDF. Now that that's out of the way, let's get into it. Before we jump into our first example problem, let's take a moment to review and make a plan to tackle these application problems. Since we're working with linear equations, each problem should have two unknown values, also known as our variables. Identifying what the variables are at the beginning can help us stay organized throughout the rest of the problem. How can I tell what a variable is in an application problem? Well, the variables are going to be things that we don't know yet. Sometimes you could find them in the question based on what you're asked to find. We also know that since these are systems, we'll be writing two equations per problem. Lastly, we could be writing equations in standard form or slope-intercept form. What are some ways I might be able to tell which type of equations I should write? For me, I find it easiest to identify when equations should be in slope-intercept form. Usually, when a scenario has a clear starting point, it represents a y-intercept, which means any equation representing it will be in slope-intercept form. So, I know that if a scenario doesn't seem to have a starting point, then it's probably going to need standard form equations instead. Now that we have a better idea of what to be looking for, let's try our first example problem. Let's read through this together. Lee needs to set up a banquet hall for a 20th wedding anniversary celebration. Since it's their 20th anniversary, they want exactly 20 tables set up to seat their 150 total guests. Lee could put out round tables that seat 6 guests each, and square tables that seat 8 guests each. How many of each type of table should Lee set up to meet the party's request? Okay, this feels like a lot, but I know I can take it one step at a time. Starting with my variables. What are my variables in this problem? In other words, what two things do I not know yet? Sometimes the question itself can help with this. It asks how many of each type of table Lee should put out. That tells me that I don't know yet how many round tables he needs and how many square tables he needs. Those are my two variables. Does it matter which is X and which is Y? Sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. When one variable depends on the other, then it's important that X is independent and Y is dependent. A good rule of thumb is that in slope-intercept equations, it does matter, but in standard form equations, it does not. Since I'm not sure which kind of equations we're working with yet, I am not going to define which variable is X and which is Y just yet. I'll come back to that soon. Now that we've identified the variables, pause the video and take a moment to annotate the problem text and identify key information. Be on the lookout for anything that'll translate well into math, and feel free to color code your annotations to help group information. Sometimes I'm tempted to just highlight all of the numbers in a problem, but just because something is a number doesn't necessarily mean it's important. For example, this 20 is just telling us what the event is about, a 20th wedding anniversary. I don't need to highlight that. But 20 tables. Since I'm trying to find out information about the number of each type of table, this is probably going to be important. 150 total guests. The word total here makes me think about having an equation be equal to 150. I'll have to keep that in mind. Round tables seat 6 guests each. Each can be a word that represents multiplication, like per. So I'm going to put round tables and six guests each in another color highlight to show that that information goes together. And I'm going to do the same thing here for square tables, which seat eight guests each. Whew, okay. Now we're back to the question, which we already covered when we identified our variables. Let's summarize all of our key information. We know he needs to use 20 total tables. There are 150 total guests. Round tables seat six guests each, and square tables seat eight guests each. Okay, let's shift all this up so that we have more space. Before we try to write any equations, do you think we'll be working in slope-intercept form or standard form in this problem? There's no starting point here. It's not like there are already any tables out, so I don't think I'm going to be writing equations in slope-intercept form. And that means our equations must be in standard form. That means it doesn't matter which variable is which. So I'll make the number of round tables my x variable, and the number of square tables my y variable. Pause the video here and try writing two equations to represent this scenario on your own. First, I knew that six guests per round table translates to 6x, and eight guests per square table translates to 8y. And each of these terms represent the number of total guests sitting at each type of table. So if I combine those, that gives me the total number of guests sitting at any table, which should be equal to 150. Since that's how many total guests are going to be at the party. If it wasn't equal to 150, that would mean that either there were too many chairs, or maybe that there were some guests who didn't even have a chair. And we don't want that. So equal to 150 it is. What about the second equation, though? Well, if I get rid of what we've already used, I still haven't used the fact that I need exactly 20 tables. Oh, the number of round tables plus the number of square tables has to be 20. So x plus y equals 20. Perfect. So this is our system of equations, and now it's time to solve it. Go ahead and pause one more time here to solve this system on your own. Since both of these equations are in standard form with all of the like parts lined up, I'm going to solve by elimination. If you solved in a different way, that's okay too. We'll still get the same answer. I'll multiply my bottom equation by negative 6 to create opposite coefficients for the x terms. Then when I add my equations, I get that 2y equals 30, or y is 15. I could substitute that back into any of my equations to solve and get that x is 5. So my solution is 5, 15. But this problem didn't ask me for a point. It asked me how many of each type of table Lee should put out. How should I write my answer? Yeah, Lee needs 5 round tables, since that's what x represents, and 15 square tables, since that's what y represents. And that's our final answer. Here's our second example problem. You may want to pause here and read through this problem on your own first. It says, Kelsey and Sabrina are saving money to go to a theme park together. They want to have the same amount of money as each other so they can purchase matching souvenirs and play all the same arcade games together. Kelsey already has $75 set aside and will save an additional $10 per week. Sabrina doesn't have any money set aside yet, but she'll save $25 per week. How long will it be until both girls have the same amount of money saved? And how much money will they each have? There's definitely a lot of information here, but I know you can do this. Start by identifying what the two variables are and annotating key information in the problem. Then, determine if you should be writing your equations in standard form or slope-intercept form. Then it's time to write and solve your system. Pause the video here and try to complete this whole problem on your own. Let's go over this together. Based on the question, I was able to figure out that the variables are how many weeks it's been and how much money each girl has. Okay, in the last problem, it didn't matter which variable was X and which was Y, but in this problem, it does. That's because the amount of money the girls have depends on how much time it's been. That means that time, or the number of weeks, is the independent variable X, and the amount of money is the dependent variable Y. I identified the key information as Kelsey's current savings, which is $75, and the amount of money she's additionally saving weekly, $10. Notice that I highlighted the information in a separate color to remind myself that they go together. I also identified Sabrina's current savings, which is zero, and her weekly savings, which is $25 a week. I put those in another color to show that they go together too. I think that's everything that I need from this problem. Now I'm going to summarize my key info again so that I don't have to keep referencing back to the problem text. Summarizing the key info is also a great way to make sure that you understand everything you've identified, and it's a great way to stay organized. That's better. If you were stuck before, now is a great time to pause and try to finish solving this on your own. Since I do have some clear starting points here, and a clear independent and dependent variable, I know I'm going to be writing my equations in slope-intercept form. I can write one for Kelsey's savings, which would be y equals 10x plus 75. The y-intercept is how much money she already has, and the slope is her weekly savings. I can also write an equation for Sabrina, which is just y equals 25x. I could write in plus zero to show that Sabrina currently has $0, but it's not necessary. The slope represents the $25 that Sabrina is saving per week. Now that I've written my equations, I can get rid of my key info and I can solve. If you haven't yet solved your system, go ahead and pause here to try solving on your own first. All of the like parts of my equations are lined up, so I could use elimination, but since my y variable in each equation is already isolated, I'm going to use substitution. No matter what method you use to solve, you should still get the same answer. I'll substitute 25x for y in the top equation and solve to get that x equals 5. I can take that 5 and substitute it in for x in either of my equations, and solve to get that y equals 125. Okay, so my solution is 5, 125. But what does that mean? The problem asked how long it'll be until both girls have the same amount of money saved, and how much they'll each have. X represents the number of weeks, so it'll take 5 weeks for them to have the same amount of money saved. And y represents how much money they have. So at that time, they'll each have $125. Wow, writing down what each of my variables means really helps me make sense of the solution. Now you can represent real-life scenarios with linear systems. Remember to start by identifying the two variables. Then annotate key information and determine if you'll be using standard form or slope-intercept form for each equation. Then write and solve the system. Also, be sure to interpret your final answer by writing out what it means so you can clearly connect your solving to the actual scenario. Now that we're finished up with the lesson video, you're ready to move on to the online practice. Good luck, and I'll see you next time.